This is the story of British Airways Flight 888. On the 11th of May 1976, a British Airways 747 was on its way from London to Melbourne, which stopped in Bahrain, Bangkok, and Kuala Lumpur. Fun fact, this flight was operated by the BOAD, or the British Airways Overseas Division. I did not know that they had an entire separate division for their overseas operations. We join Flight 888 at night as it makes its way from Bangkok to Kuala Lumpur with 104 people on board. The captain was the one flying, and tonight he'd be landing on runway 15 at Kuala Lumpur's Subang International Airport. The approach called for them to overfly the Victor Bravo Alpha VOR. It was situated 15 nautical miles from the threshold of runway 15 and 1 nautical mile to the north of the extended centerline. They had to pass the Victor Bravo Alpha VOR at least 2,000 feet, and after that, they could head towards the November Mike Beacon, which was on the runway's extended centerline. You had to maintain 860 feet as you passed over the November Mike Beacon, and only start descending when you had the runway in sight and when you were on the glideslope. With the briefing out of the way, the crew calibrated their altimeters and their radio altimeters. Their radio altimeters would start warning them when they were at about 866 feet above the ground. It would start making a sound at 866 feet, and as they descended, it would get louder and louder till they hit 791 feet. Soon, the approach was underway. The plane overflew the Victor Bravo Alpha VOR. The runway lights shone in the dark landscape, guiding the plane towards the airport. Having passed the Victor Bravo Alpha VOR, the plane descended down to 860 feet near their decision altitude. A warning sound played, indicating that they were near their decision height. As this warning buzzed in the background, the captain called for flaps 20 and for the gear to be lowered. Flaps are the surfaces that extend from the trailing edge of the wing. They help the plane generate more lift at low speeds. They come out in increments. For example, at the flaps 1 setting, they come out a little bit. Then at the flaps 5 setting, they come out a little bit more, and even more at the flaps 10 setting. You get the idea? As the gear came down, one of the landing gear warning light became dislodged from its holder socket, and so the flight engineer had to verify the status of the gear on his panel, thus disrupting his checklist. The captain does not notice that no one had extended the flaps to 20. Neither pilot replied with flaps 20, confirming that they had done what the captain had asked, nor did the captain follow up on this. As the plane approached the November Mike Beacon, the plane was carrying a bit too much speed as no one had extended the flaps. The flaps generate a lot of drag, and they help slow the plane down. Ideally, the plane should be a bit slower, so now the captain was doing three things at once. He had to line the plane up with the runway, maintain altitude, and find a way to lose some speed. The plane was nearing the November Mike Beacon, and slowly the huge 747 started descending. The pilots in the cockpit were unaware of what their plane was doing. The plane overflew the November Mike Beacon, and the captain called for flaps 25. The first officer asked in a confused voice, 25 from 10? Remember, he had not heard the call to extend the flaps to 20. So he's confused about the captain skipping flaps 20. But the captain did not reply to the first officer's query. In the cockpit, each pilot went back to what they had been doing. The captain flew the plane, the first officer operated the radio, and the flight engineer went back to his landing checks. Both the flight engineer and the first officer verified that the flaps were at 25. The captain then scanned his instruments just to see if everything was all right. When he looked back up, he expected to see the bright lights of runway 15 out in front of him. What he saw probably made his blood run cold. There was nothing out there. No runway lights, nothing. He did not have time to be shocked. His first officer called out, 100 feet above ground level. His radio altimeter was telling him that the plane was just 150 feet off the ground. The captain needed to act. He pushed the engines to the max. Engine 1 surged and then recovered, but this meant that the plane was yawing from side to side. The massive jet scraped the tops of the trees, The only thing stopping the jumbo from crashing into the trees were the four engines. The engines were not a go-around power, but whatever power that they had would have to do. The crew carried out a go-around at the literal last second with less than maximum go-around power. Thankfully, it was enough, and the plane climbed away. As they climbed away, the flight engineer was convinced that they had struck the ground, but the captain disagreed. But just to be safe, they orbited the Kilo Lima beacon and carried out some maneuvering and control checks. If their plane was damaged, then they needed to know before they attempted another landing. As far as they could tell, the plane had not sustained any damage. With everything checking out, the captain landed the plane on runway 33 with emergency crew standing by, just in case. On the ground, the flight engineer was proven right. The plane had not hit the ground, but the engines and the landing gear all showed telltale signs of tree strikes. In the light of day, it became clear how close Flight 888 had come to disaster. The plane had flown through someone's estate, which was full of rubber trees. The plane had knocked down huge branches in a patch that was 200 meters long and 30 meters wide. That is 656 by 98 feet for those who prefer imperial. The impact was so forceful that the plane had knocked down two fully grown trees. I'm just absolutely amazed that flying through 200 meters of treetops did not take out an engine or two, especially when the engines showed signs of damage. They could see indentations in the forest canopy that the engines had scooped out. Had the engines failed, this story would have ended very differently. After the plane had landed, the Malaysian authorities conducted tests to see if the beacons were functioning normally. The beacons were fine. They also found that the runway was visible from where the plane should have been. They found that the plane had to be dangerously low for the foliage to obscure the lights of the runway. When they looked at the data for the flight, the 747 at first looked like it was flying a textbook approach. It passed the Victor Bravo Alpha beacon as expected, except for one small thing. It was a bit too fast. In addition to that, flaps 10 was delayed, and they didn't even select flaps 20 when they were supposed to. This meant that, going into the last leg of the flight, the plane was much faster than it should have been. But too much speed would not cause an accident, at least not in this case. As the plane approached November Mike, the plane began to drop a bit. The investigators believed that this was unintentional. If you recall, flaps 20 had been called for, but flaps 20 was not selected. In the mind of the captain, the flaps were at 20, and he expected the plane to behave a certain way, for it to have a certain level of pitch, etc. So he's trying to reconcile this deviation, and he does not notice that his plane has started to descend. Sure, one person can make a mistake. We're all human after all. That's why the non-flying pilot must be monitoring instruments in critical phases of flight, like the one that they were in. The BOAD required the first officer to monitor the altitude of the plane when they were less than 2,500 feet above the ground. This requirement was brought about after a near miss at Nairobi. Let me know if you want to see a video on that. But the first officer was not monitoring their altitude as he should have been. They had just missed an opportunity to catch their mistake. After this, the captain was occupied with slowing the plane down and lining the plane up with the runway. So he puts the plane into a slight left turn and pulls back power. The plane started descending even more. It was at this point that the captain called for flaps 25. Communication in the cockpit was breaking down. A quote, critical situation was developing, and no one seemed to realize it. This still makes no sense. A well-trained pilot should have no problem flying this approach. The crew were not tired, and they themselves said that they were not fatigued. So the investigators looked at the pilots themselves. The captain had undergone some conversion training to fly the 747. His performance was, quote, marginally acceptable. They decided to look at the previous incident that occurred in similar circumstances. In both cases, the captains got tied up in what they were doing, and they tuned out everything else that was happening around them. In the case of Flight 888, the captain was laser-focused on slowing the plane down and lining the plane up, so much so that he ignored the plane's altitude. This accident shows that just writing and ratifying rules isn't enough. It's very easy to put out a memo that says, you all must work as a team and you should always cross-check each other's work and catch each other's mistakes. But training pilots to actually do that and to work as a team is an entirely different task. You have to verify that the training and education that you give results in a safer operating environment. The report gives us an example of how this can be done. When pilots are trained on a new airplane, some pilots will adapt, no problem. But some will have a bit of trouble, like the captain of Flight 888. There should be a system in place inside the airline where they can identify someone who's having a bit of trouble so that the airline can focus in on that pilot and give them some additional training so that in the end, all pilots at the airline are well-trained and ready to handle anything. But do you know who I really feel bad for, though? The person whose hundreds of trees were destroyed by a jumbo jet. Imagine them filling out an insurance claim for that. Yes, officer, a jumbo jet flew through my plantation and destroyed my trees. I really hope someone compensated them for that. Thank you for watching this episode of Mini Air Crash Investigation. If you like the videos that I make, do consider liking and subscribing. It will really help the channel grow. I will catch you guys next time. Stay safe.